Good evening and welcome to the City of Revere's School Safety Community Forum. And I don't think I have to go into too much detail about why we're doing this, but I want to thank everyone for coming out tonight. And I'll start by thanking a couple of the elected officials who are here. I want to express my gratitude for them to show up tonight. We have school committee members, Aisha Milbury Ellis and Susan Gravelisi. We also have city councilors, Patrick Keefe and Anthony Cogliandro. I will say, I want to thank school committee member Gravelisi for being the driving force as the chair of school safety subcommittee and making something like this happen and making sure that everyone understands that we're being proactive. And I think that's a theme you'll hear tonight, that we as a community want to be proactive. And we're gonna do a couple of things. We're gonna provide some information for our families and for our residents. We're gonna make sure that you understand that we're being proactive and that there are steps that everyone can take to make sure that we're being proactive when it comes to community safety and especially school safety. We also wanna have an opportunity to hear from you. So there will be an opportunity for questions and answers, and we're hopeful that this will be a real dialogue and an open conversation about what we're doing and how you can be part of making sure that our school community is safe. I'll close by saying we have the best people in uniform who are in charge of public safety. Between our police department and our fire department, we have unbelievable people who live and breathe making sure that we're all safe. And I just want to give a special plug to the folks who work in our schools, especially our school resource officers, who are the lifeblood of school safety. And their work is, I know it goes a little under the radar. They get a lot of, I hope, a lot of credit, but I just want to say that up front, that the folks that we have in uniform, in and out of schools, but the folks that we have in uniform in our police and fire department are the best people in the Commonwealth. And I'm lucky to be able to work with them every day. With that, I'm gonna pass it off to Dr. Kelly, and we're gonna hear from folks, and you'll see a quick presentation from a number of folks on the public safety side. Thank you.
Thanks, Mr. Mayor. You have the perfect message there. I think that one of the key things I want to emphasize is what incredible partners we have in the Revere Fire Department and in the Revere Police Department. People often think that schools are institutions unto themselves, but the work that we do with this team is invaluable in making sure that our students and our staff are all safe on a day-to-day basis. And we connect with them regularly. I'm talking about at least every 2 weeks that we're in communication. The two chiefs, the fire chief and the police chief, and I are fortunate to be on the mayor's cabinet. So we have weekly meetings that we're all in the same room together and talk about what's happening and what we're worried about and what we are hearing in the community and what things each one of us should be focused on to ensure that safety at all times. And in addition, as the mayor referenced, the school committee has a subcommittee focused solely on school safety, and that is led by committee woman Gravelisi. And also on that committee are school committee members Kingston and Ty. And they are, when anything happens anywhere in the United States that involves school safety, they are very quick to pull us together, have a meeting, talk about what happened, talk about what we do to prevent that or what we need to do to prevent a similar event occurring here. And that's some of what I know Captain O'Hara and Sergeant Turner are gonna get into a little bit more as we progress. So I won't say anything else except to say that in the schools, safety is one of our main priorities. And we have an incredible team, not only in the school resource officers, but also in our school security personnel, two of whom are here with us tonight, Mr. Cogliandro and Erica is here from the Beachmont. And without that team together to help us to really be the eyes of the building, we wouldn't be as safe as we are. So we're very thankful to them as well, because they really keep us on target and make sure that anything unusual happening is noticed, commented on, and taken care of.
Thank you, Dr. Kelly. Thank you, Mayor, for those kind words. I'd like to say hello to everybody. Thanks for being here tonight and inviting us to this forum. Thank Revere TV for being here to broadcast it live and to record it for people who couldn't be here tonight. They can watch it later. We're here to let the community know that, you know, your public safety and your school people are on the ball with these issues. We've been training together for many years now on these type of things. The fire department, as you're probably aware, you know, we're pretty well versed in all emergencies. We call it all hazard emergencies, not just fires, but could be hazardous materials incidents, it could be weather incidents, and anything else you could imagine. So we are pretty well versed in you know, coming into a crazy situation, trying to gain some control, or what we call unified command, you know, so we can kind of get control of a situation, you know. And those are the things that we bring to the table. We do a lot of training with mass casualty incidents. We do training for hemorrhage control and stuff like that for these types of incidents. We have all the equipment. We have all the gear. We're good to go on this stuff. Captain Wolfgang, my training officer, will speak a little bit more about that after me. But we're here to kind of ensure the community that we're here and we're prepared, and we will act if the unthinkable, and we hope never would happen. But I think more importantly, tonight's message is going to be that everybody has a stake in our safety. You know, the parents, the students, and I think this community does it better than most. There's a real good, they've been really working on these relationships for years with the school resource officers and Dr. Kelly, her staff, police, fire. I mean, you know, they've been working on this. So I think our best defense is really, you know, everyone having a stake, see something, say something, listen, don't take anything for granted, report things. And that's our best chance, is to head these things off before they become a major incident on the 6 o'clock news. So without further ado, I'll pass it off to, oh, I'm sorry, Chief Callahan down here.
Thank you, Chief Bright. I want to thank the mayor, the city council, and the school committee for the support that we receive for public safety in the community. We're very fortunate that the city government, the entire city government, supports the fire department and the police department wholeheartedly. And that makes our jobs a little easier. But I want to thank everybody for coming. And Revere TV, thank you for putting this out there for people who can't attend tonight. And these are difficult conversations to have, but it's reality. And myself personally, I worked in the schools for several years, so I understand, you know, the concern people have. And, you know, unfortunately, I was in the school department working as a, you know, like a resource officer, a liaison to the school department when the unfortunate, terrible incident happened in Columbine. And that was one of the first big mass active shooter incidents that happened in the country, was Columbine. So it changed a lot of things, how we looked at them, how we reacted, how the police trained to react to those situations. And we'll continue to do that now. And as Chief Bright said, we work collaboratively with the fire department, the school department. Tonight, I was hoping to get Lieutenant Bossy, who's the barracks commander on the Revere Beach Station, to come, but he already had a prior commitment. We work with the state police as well. So we have partnerships in place, and there's always constant communication, and we try to move forward. We try to reassess what we're doing all the time, and if we need to make changes, we do them. So, you know, I can assure you that hopefully we can prevent one of these incidents from happening, just with some of the things we have in place and the open lines of communication and how everybody talks, and we try to get on the same page all the time. And I just want to thank everybody for coming, and now I'll pass it on to the next person, Captain O'Hara. Thank you again.
Hello, everyone. I'm Richie Gallucci. I'm the Assistant Superintendent of Revere Public Schools. I am one of the point people in our central office team for working with all of these fine partners that sit on the stage with us. I think to echo what Mayor Arrigo said at the very forefront, a lot of our work is proactive, and there is a ton of work that goes on behind the scenes that's not publicized. And what I would say is tonight is a great opportunity for us to present some information to the public without sacrificing confidentiality, of course, but to be able to tell you the things that we do on a regular, weekly, and annual basis to keep our schools safe. So without further ado, I'm going to transition to Captain O'Hara.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Amy O'Hara. I'm a captain with the Revere Police. I overlook the school resource officers. So these conversations are really tough, right? Because we're talking about the safety of our kids in the community, and that really resonates with all of us. But conversations about safety happen at almost every day, at every level, between all the leaders right here. It's serious work, and we take it really seriously. I want to talk a little bit about who the school resource officers are and what they do in the school, and then later on I'm going to come back and talk about a really important, which is a piece of school safety, and that's prevention, right? So currently we have three school resource officers that work in our school district. Officer Brian Brennis, Officer Joe Singer, and Sergeant Intonicola. And I just want to reiterate what the mayor said and what everybody said here. The school resource officers, we're so grateful for them. Their phones are on 24/7. They're selected for these roles. The selection process, we pick people who are going to be fair and consistent. They have good judgment. They're committed to the safety of our students, and they care about our kids. And the three school resources that we have, they're very committed. All three of them, and myself, are lifelong residents and all proud graduates of Revere High School. So we have real connection to this community. So like I said, selection is made for the school resource officers. They're some of the most highly trained in the department, not only tactically, but in other areas like crisis intervention, trauma-informed leadership training, bias training, race and equity training, and then specialized training in bullying prevention and social media risks. Some of the most highly trained that we have. They serve as mentors, informal counselors, and resource providers. They work consistently daily with our school department. There's mandated training that they have to go through every year. That's state mandated on juvenile law that they have to be updated on. They also have to review emergency plans every year at the start of the school year. There's an introduction every year to the school community of the school resource officers, and they work with security in each school. And this year, we're going to add a little bit more to the school some of the security staff in the different schools about situational awareness to how to report things and look for concerning behavior. Like I said, it says biweekly meetings, but we all know meetings happen quite frequently, and we're always in touch with each other. So I'm going to hand this off to the next person, but I'm going to come back to talk about some really important components of prevention.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Captain Mark Wolfgang from the Fire Department, and I'm just going to stand over here so I can see the slide. I'm just going to talk briefly about what we do on an annual basis for emergency planning in the schools. We do run, it's mandated by law, we do 4 emergency drills per year in the schools, every school, 4 times, and that's quarterly. The first one we do within a week of school opening, so we can get the children acclimated to what they should be doing. I will tell you the younger kids pick it up much quicker and are on the ball and follow their teacher's directions, and they're great. The older kids, a bit slower, you know, they know everything, but you know, they get moving, and they also listen to directions from the teachers and the staff. We focus on evacuation and accounting for all individuals in the schools, including staff, including teaching staff and non-teaching staff, as well as the kids, of course. Each of these two measures is timed, so we are running a stopwatch. Captain Fortuna, who does most of these drills, is running a stopwatch, and these drills are timed. And we go over the times at the end of each drill. District-wide performance reviews include us as well as the school staff. after each cycle, and we look to see how we can improve. We look for the top three positive points and the bottom three negative points, and obviously we try to improve the negative points. The principals of all the schools provide after-action feedback to staff, including, like I said, including the high points and the low points, and we just try to get rid of the low points. And we do enhanced drills during the third and final quarter of every year, and those are not your traditional emergency drill. We try to put a few roadblocks up for the students, for the staff. For instance, shelter in place, or you can't use the stairway, or you must turn right, you can't go left, etc. So that just puts a little wrinkle into what they're used to in the earlier drills. So that's really all I have for now, and I'm going to give it back to Dr. Gallucci.
Thank you, Captain Wolfgang. So in conjunction with our partners, we craft emergency response plans for each building. Some buildings house two schools, such as the school that you're in right now, houses the A.C. Whalen and the Susan B. Anthony. Ms. Ouellette and Mr. Pelletier together, along with me, and ultimately our partners review these plans, and ensure that they are effective. They are submitted to the Department of Education. Within these plans, there is a one-pager for each complex. This one-pager shows gathering areas for the complex, as well as lists personnel who have a walkie-talkie. All emergency responding staffs have this one-pager electronically. We will keep paper copies in the schools. We do keep paper copies in the schools. But in an emergency situation, to be able to identify those that we can contact with a walkie, all emergency personnel have that on electronically. Our school committee safety committee, as Dr. Kelly had mentioned, led by school committee woman Gravelisi, is invaluable. They attend our safety meetings on a regular basis. School committee woman Gravelisi, after Uvalde, the tragic incident, called together all of these partners to really encourage and put together this presentation. They are another layer of safety to our school planning. All of our Revere police squad cars have access to our buildings. We are in the process of ensuring that all 8 complexes have what we call a fob, which basically allows you to swipe a card to get into the school. And our plans and response options are consistently reviewed with staff. And over the years, we've had hold in place, which is typically used for minor situations. So if there was a medical incident in the nurse's office, we might call a hold in place for the first floor to give that student privacy if EMTs had to exit them from the building. During this type of action, the classroom door is closed, but the learning continues. The teacher doesn't stop teaching, the students don't stop learning, and the learning continues because it is a minor incident. We're just really worried about privacy. Secure in place would be kind of a threat to the school. It's a little more significant. That's an instance where the door is closed and locked. Staff, and it varies by building, would go to the place in their classroom that's out of sight. Obviously, emergency personnel would be called. And then this year, we're going to do a lot of professional development with our teachers to really outline what their options are in an emergency situation. Is it an instance where they can evacuate the building because the threat is posing imminent danger? So those are kind of protocols that we go over regularly with our students. We do it at the start of school and then throughout the school year to ensure that it's being retained. All right, now we're gonna transition to a more significant threat and emergency situation should that ever unfold. And we all hope and hope we never are faced with that. But I'm going to turn it over to Sergeant Turner to talk about the extensive work that our Revere Police Department do to be prepared for such a situation, as well as our Revere Fire Department.
Evening, everyone. Again, my name is Joe Turner. I'm a sergeant with the Revere Police Department. My current responsibilities are I run the training division. I'm also responsible for our Special Operations Unit and our Tactical Patrol Officers. What I'm here to talk about is, you know, we want to kind of be, understand this is a serious topic, and this is that worst case scenario thing. A lot of you here, that's probably kind of why you came here. You're like, hey, listen, if something bad happens, like what I've been seeing on TV lately, what are my police, my fire, my school department going to do for me and my family? So I'm going to discuss a couple points. First and foremost, you need to understand this. It is our policy, and I mean policy, as in not only is it written on paper, but we push this through training and practice and simple just culture in our agency that we will respond to a, what we could like to call an active threat incident, okay? Where there's a threat to people in a public populated place, our officers are taught to intervene, all right? Our goal is to get in there and stop the potential loss or danger to human life or stop the actual taking of such. All right. Again, it's policy, but it's not just policy. Policy is easy on paper, but it's culture where we are. Within law enforcement, the chief referenced Columbine. Columbine occurred actually when I was in junior in high school when that happened. Law enforcement prior to Columbine, the practices in the industry and the profession were that was a wait technique, just to wait it out, get tactical officers there, and then resolve it. Columbine taught a very important lesson that that was not the best practice. Law enforcement as a whole across the United States changed on that day. We realized we had to do it better. Since then, the policy that we adopt is the same for the majority of the country. All right, and that's the practice across this country. And we follow that, and we're pretty dedicated to that. There's never a realm we would ever want to step away from that. That's the accepted practice, and we have our officers focused in that realm. So, next slide. I want to give you, you have to understand that responding to a critical incident, there's multiple facets to it, all right? There's the command components, fire components, police components. Within police, there's various components. When it comes to responding to an active threat or an active shooter, we try to keep it simple to a degree, all right? We want to focus on what's the priority, and the priority is what? Your kids, all right? The priority, if it's not a school, say it's like a store, public building, it's you, okay? You guys are the priority. We actually teach what's called safety priorities. Safety priorities we use for any form of critical incident, and it lists the priorities that the tactics that we use are focused on ensuring certain groups' survival over others. We place law enforcement officers underneath innocent people. So we make sure that the tactics we teach officers to deploy in certain incidents, when it comes to things like an active shooter, that the officers' survival in that incident is not as important as the children's, your mom's, your dad's, all right? We want you guys to survive over us if it came down to that. So the tactics we deploy are intended to ensure that, all right? Our officers will intervene, all right? We are trained to do such. Within those incidents, initial officers are formed in what we call a contact element or contact team. Their job is to find the assailant, all right? That's their only job, all right? They respond to the information given, all right, either from dispatch or from you that are there, and they will locate that party, and their goal is to stop. Stop it, stop it, stop it. All right, we want whatever's going on to end. After that, the follow-on officers, once we have those contact elements, as we call them, dealing with the problem, stopping the threat, follow-on elements' job is to work with fire department personnel to do the second component, which is very important to us, rendering aid. All right, our first job as law enforcement is to stop the problem. Fire department's first priority is to render aid and save you. We help them in that process. All right, we give more of our assets with that, to them when it's allowable, and we help them deploy into the area and render aid to those people. So those are the two roles that law enforcement has when it comes to responding to such incidents. For the Revere Police Department, understand this. Again, I told you our culture and our training culture, our response culture, and just to touch on culture, you have to understand something. The things you have seen in TV and media in regards to certain incidents, amongst the officers I work with, of all ranks, from the bottom to the top, people out of the academy, people at the end of their career, it hurts to see the way certain things have been done, all right? Because we feel that where we work, we're like, that doesn't happen here, all right? Our officers, it's just known. It's just known because of the way we've trained, the way our culture is, the way we believe in our community, all right? The way we train, state of Massachusetts has no mandate on active shooter training, all right? There's other mandates we have, medical training. We're mandated to have one day a year. For for example. There is no mandate in the state of Massachusetts for active shooter training. It's up to each individual jurisdiction agency to decide if they want to do that or not. We, approximately 5 years ago, started implementing yearly training on our own. We just decided it was something that was important to us. During that time, Revere Fire Department actually reached out to us. Captain Wolfgang, that was my first encounter with Captain Wolfgang, was he reached out to me and he was like, hey, I got a good idea. We should start pushing this joint work in these programs. And we did, and ever since then, we've been inseparable to that. This year, myself and Captain Wolfgang started planning our active shooter training in the, we'll say late winter, springish, is when we started doing that for this year's training, which we usually do in the summertime because schools are closed. Ashley, as we speak right now, this week, we've been conducting active shooter training. We were over at the high school yesterday and today. We were over there. The people that are training our officers, including myself, we're trained by state standards in Massachusetts. Massachusetts, while it doesn't mandate an active shooter hourly requirement, it does mandate a certain system that all officers in the state of Massachusetts are trained in. Myself and other officers are certified in that. We're also certified nationally. I've been to several schools. A lot of my staff have been to several schools in regards to active shooter response. We have trained in both techniques of training law enforcement officers, and some of us have been trained in techniques of training civilians. The active shooter topic is very deep in breadth, and you can never stop learning about it and how to respond to it and how to better teach officers. Within our police force, we have different programs of response. We have different response options. Every officer has different roles in law enforcement. You have trainers, traffic officers, investigative officers, command staff officers, and things like that. Within our patrol force has specialties within it. One of those specialties is called the Tactical Patrol Officer Program. It's called TPO. Tactical patrol officers are your regular patrol officers. You wouldn't know the difference between that patrol officer and another one. All right, but they're taught additional tactical, lack of a better term, skill sets. All right, those skill sets are meant to deal with high-risk incidents, such as an active shooter. All right, that training is in addition to active shooter training, which everybody gets. So tactical patrol officers not only get their regular active shooter training, they get additional tactical training on how to respond to such an incident. How we train, this year is a great example. We have a whole day that every officer gets. First half of the day, all right, is focused on the contact team element, where they're responding. We put officers into stress scenarios where we make them make decisions and face adversaries, and then we shoot actual training ammunition at them. It's actually a little paintball. It's like little paintballs. And it hurts, all right? And that hurt is a good thing, all right? Because the officer learns a lesson. They learn to deal with their fear and fight, all right? Just today, I had to deal with 25 officers, all right, who had to work to clear into classrooms to deal with an adversary, all right? The goal in that training was to teach our officers that when they're stressed out in such an incident, that they will continue to move forward and stop the threat. The second half of the training day was with fire. All right, we worked with the fire department personnel came in with their different companies, and we worked with them in multiple repetitions of practicing deploying through the hallways to a location where there was people that needed help. All right, our officers provided protection for those FD personnel while they rendered aid to the people that were inside that room. That's how we train. We try to cover all our bases. We try to address everything that we could see might happen in that future. That we don't want to happen, but we want to make sure that we're prepared for it to happen. Lastly, our preparation. So when we talked about people, like an officer, we talk about software, okay? So when we're training a police officer, I'm training the chief or the captain or anything like that, we're putting software into that captain or that chief, okay? We're putting software into that patrol officer, all right? We're teaching them tactics and techniques to resolve a problem. But guess what? Sometimes it helps with tools, all right? Tools are great, all right? Tools don't solve the problem, but they help a lot. One of the biggest tools I can definitely say that in my career, I've been in law enforcement 17 years, that key card that the school department pushed through a very long, arduous grant program that I've worked with the captain over here and the chief, all right, and the school department, those key cards that give us access to schools is huge. Law enforcement traditionally has always had a problem getting into buildings to stop these problems. Now every cruiser, every police car, all right, in Revere, right to the right of that police officer is a little itty-bitty little pocket, and the card's right there. He can grab it very easily and access into the school. That is huge for us. Other things that we have to resolve these problems, all right, patrol rifles, all right? Patrol rifles, for us, it's about not missing what we're intending to shoot at and stopping it quickly. That's a very important tool in active shooter response through the distances of school hallways. Breaching equipment. huge topic across the country, again, in regards to getting into rooms. All right, the key card gets us in the building, but how do we get into a locked teacher's classroom? Every single one of our line cards has what's called a Halligan tool, which is actually common in firefighters. All right, it's a tool meant to pry things open. All of our officers have that. All of our TPOs are trained in that. Tactical medical bags. Several years ago, we applied for a very large grant for school safety, and we got tactical trauma aid bags for all of our police cars. Those bags have things like tourniquets, chest seals, combat dressings, which are just very beefed up dressings. All right, our officers went through 2 years of, incorporated over the course of 2 years, training programs to teach all of our officers how to use that equipment. In addition, upgraded body armor, okay? Depending on the type of, we'll say, weapons an assailant has, not all body armor stops all weapons. We had upgraded body armor installed on all cruisers to give officers options, to give them more beefed up protection if they had to respond in such an incident. Lastly, active shooter bags. Active shooter bags are intended to give the officer the tools they need when they go into the structure. So they don't have to worry about grabbing a bunch of things. They grab one bag, they go into the structure, and they solve the problem. I don't want to point at other areas. I don't want to sit there and say better than others or anything like that, but the fact is this. This city, if you do your research, fact check me. Please fact check anything anybody up here says. Check with other agencies around us or the cities around us. We are definitely at the top when it comes to the equipment and the training side of the house when it comes to active shooter. The stuff that's in our cars, most other agencies around us don't have. Our active shooter mandate that we instilled ourselves, most agencies around us do not have. All right? I'm very proud of that. I'm very proud that I've never gotten any pushback in this city. There's not been one person in government, police, fire, that's ever said, not a good idea. All right? We have been doing this for years. The only thing that's been rough is COVID. COVID slowed us down for training. We've been biting at the bit to do this. And it's been great this week to be back with fire doing this again. So I can say that from our standpoint, our guys' response, all right, the Revere Police Department is prepared to respond to this. Our officers are good at what they do. And when it comes to this unfortunate topic, all right, they will be there when you need them to be there.
Thank you, Sergeant Turner. All right, we're going to transition to what we feel is the most important proactive preventative measure. It's a sign of good teaching, but it's also the quality that makes schools safe, and that is relationships between our staff and our students and our families. And I'll turn it over to Captain O'Hara to talk about what some of the research says and then tell you a little bit about what we do with our children and our staff and our school communities.
Thank you, Richie. So you've heard a lot about our comprehensive safety plans, but I want to talk to you about one of the most overlooked components of school safety, but it's the most important, and everybody here has a say. It's really important. I want to talk to you about some of the research. So you'll see it says prevention, relationships, and support are the key to ensuring safe schools, students, and staff. This is the truth. This is what we know. It's common sense in law enforcement about building trust in our community. But research says it too. There's been considerable research on these types of incidents at the local, state, and federal level. As a matter of fact, the National Policing Foundation conducted a research, and what they did is they looked at completed acts of violence and those that were averted. They know that these types of attacks are not a sudden event. It's often something that takes planning. So, preparation and understanding of what we learn from this is very important, but it's not surprising to us. Can you bring on the next slide? Okay. So students are often the first to know of a planned attack. Think about that. Students are often the first to know, whether through a peer, through the grapevine, or social media. So think about that. So this area right here, I want really everybody to pay attention. This is important. Most of these incidents were averted because a student reported concerns to a trusted adult, a parent, a teacher, a police officer, about a student's concerning behavior, and then action was taken. So what does that mean? Why are they coming forward? They're coming forward because there's trusted relationships in place, right? They're trusting the school resource officers whose one of their goals is to create positive youth interactions. You know, Officer Singer has a boxing program. They're in programming throughout the city. And it's not just the school resource officers. The hallmark of what we do is to build trust. It's effective policing, and it keeps our community secure and safe. So we want students, we want the community to feel safe to come to us. You're going to go to the school department or another trusted adult, but know to come to us and report concerning behavior. To do that, you have to trust us. That's why we work really hard on community engagement. It's the foundation of what we do.
And Captain O'Hara, I just jump in on that second point to say, as someone who oversees safety and works with our principals on a regular basis, I couldn't be more proud of our students and the subsequent call that we get from a parent or guardian or caretaker at 4 or 5 p.m. to say, this was said early this morning at 9 a.m. In science class, and we're really concerned about that. And even though we get that call when the parent, guardian, or caretaker immediately finds out at 4 or 5 p.m., we as a team are always able to act and follow up with the student that was at the center of the concern and their family. And that quick, immediate reporting, I just can't say how important and impressive that is, because we regularly get calls, our principals get calls from parents after hours, if a student reports to them that they heard something concerning at school.
Thank you. The last one says, the primary reason students gave for not reporting their concerns, right? Not reporting. They didn't take the information they learned seriously. So we need to have an atmosphere, if you see something, you have to say something. That's not just students, that's everybody in the community. And concerning behavior is just, you know it, something's not right that you hear or see. When you have that, report it and talk to us. We'll take it from there, but you have to take that step when something concerning you come across, and talk to your kids about it. Because if you look at that, they didn't come forth because they didn't think it was serious. So I'd like to read a couple of the top lines here. It says, the climate and culture of our school and district community is the most powerful determiner for keeping our schools safe. In the collaboration of the community, schools, families, public safety is really, really important. We all have to be committed to keeping our community safe. So I'm going to say it again. Establishing relationships built on trust and respect creates an atmosphere where students come forward. Now, I know that's a lot of writing up there, but I'm telling you, the key to safety is prevention. We don't want to get where Sergeant Turner and the chiefs are talking about. We want to be right here. And research shows that these events are averted because we're in a community that trusts each other and comes forward. So Revere is a diverse, opinionated community. I know we all agree in one thing, right? And that's security of our kids in the community at large. So please, that is very important. Come forward with information and continue to just bring any type of concerning behavior forward. And I like to say this, school safety is everyone's responsibility. It's true. If you see something, say something.
All right. So some of our efforts as a school district and our partnerships. So in 2021, our district went through a mental health audit from an objective outside partner. As a result, we began to increase our counseling staff across our high schools, middle schools, and elementary schools. We established a director of physical and emotional health and wellness position to oversee that work. We've hired 4 school psychologists and 4 board-certified behavior analysts. We've embedded social-emotional learning practices throughout our school programming. We've established separate social-emotional learning blocks, such as advisory at the secondary levels and morning meeting at our elementary levels. There was one middle school that decided not to have advisory, but that administration is working with that teaching staff, who decided that advisory didn't fit into the schedule, to ensure that social-emotional learning practices are embedded within the classes throughout the day. And certainly something that can be revisited if they then decide, the teacher and staff then decides that they would like to have a separate advisory block. Advisory and morning meeting were really ramped up during the pandemic. Our kids needed it more than ever, and it's provided great avenues for establishing strong relationships between the students and the teaching staff and the staff beyond the teaching staff. We give annual student surveys that ask the kids directly, how safe do you feel at school? And we gauge how safe our students feel on a regular basis as they attend their elementary, middle, and high school. We have a number of partnerships, too many to name, but some of the ones that have recently been incredible supports to us are North Suffolk Mental Health, the Home for Little Wanderers, Italian Home, Department of Children and Families, of course, MGH, Revere Cares, Sandy Hook Promise, that I will give an example about in just a few slides, the Suffolk County District Attorney's Office for any significant situation. We work with them regularly. The Children's Advocacy Center of Suffolk County, another invaluable partner, and many others who support our work that often extends beyond the school day, especially when there is a student or a family in need of services that extend beyond school counseling and the supports that we have during our school programming. So I'm going to give a few examples. One at the elementary level that was established. We have morning meeting at the elementary level. The purpose of morning meeting is not to do the ABCs and 1-2-3s. It's to talk about students' social actions, their emotional state, and to really connect with the students and the teachers. A typical morning meeting finds students gathered in a circle for about 15 to 20 minutes. There could be a topic of the day, there could be a goal setting exercise, but more importantly, it's connection. It's establishing trusted adults within the school community. It is designated for social emotional work, so it's not an academic component of our school program, and we feel that that's so important. As I had mentioned, the advisory block at the middle school equally is important. And really, and this is feedback from our principals, that it's really generated a greater sense of belonging and connectedness to the school community. We hear that from our children all the time. They enjoy that block. They enjoy that block when they're having a good day, and they know they can get the help and support they need when they're not having a good day. And it's become a really, really integral part of our program. So at the secondary level, all of our students at over the past 2 years, from grades 6 through 12, we've worked with a partner called the Sandy Hook Promise. And Sandy Hook Promise is dedicated to proactive measures that can prevent school violence. And I think what you'll, if you went through the training with your children, what you would see is that a lot of these measures involve relationships. Their goal is to reduce bullying, it's to reduce isolation, and to increase connections throughout the school community. And not just connections between the students and staff, between students and students. And the first program that our students received was a program called Start With Hello. And really what they learned in this is identifying someone who's beginning to isolate from peer groups. And then reaching out and trying to interact and socialize with that person. And the easiest way is to start by saying hi. The kids really enjoyed it. I know when we were live prior to the pandemic, we even did role playing where we'd have a student isolating and another student who was a peer leader would go over to say hello and spark up a conversation. And that's the first proactive step in all of this prevention work that we're doing. The second part of the Sandy Hook partnership was to say something that you've heard a lot throughout this presentation. This was a little more intensive. It asked our kids to begin recognizing signs of things that they were concerned about, encourage them to act immediately, to tell a trusted adult, and to say something to whoever they trusted in that school community that they knew they could to get help and the support that they felt either they need or a peer needs. I feel as though since this training, we've had a lot more reports. We're very transparent in our communication with our families. When there is a concerning incident at a school, we often write about it. I would say 95% of those were brought to us by students. Students who saw something and went to a trusted adult, either within the school community or in their home. So what can we do as a whole community? I think it's great to have conversations with your child about school safety and specific school protocols. Within the first 3 days, they're going to experience an evacuation drill with the Revere Fire Department, as they do every year. Ask how it went. Did they evacuate quickly? Did everything go well? Explain the importance of speaking to adults when a child has a concern about what they've seen or heard. It's never too late. If it happened on Monday and they're telling you on Thursday, we still want that report on a Thursday. This is probably the key, and having been a former middle school principal, I would say that this is invaluable. I think Every child should have three go-to adults in a school setting. Staff members that they have the strongest connection and bond with. And I think it's equally important for the parent, guardian, or caretaker to know who those three adults are. It could be a science teacher, it could be a social worker, it could be an assistant principal. Sometimes it varies, sometimes it's three teachers. Sometimes it's their advisory teacher or their morning meeting push-in teacher. But definitely ask your child, who are your three go-to adults in the school building? And then reiterating, if you ever have a concern, those are your people. Go to them. One has to be present. Become familiar with your students, your school's contact information. We do have a nice new website. I was on it a lot this week. Definitely familiarize yourself of who you can call or reach if you have something to report. And I think Captain O'Hara in a few slides will tell you, if it is extremely late and it still needs to be reported, then Revere Police would be your avenue for reporting. And then contact the school. As I said, it's never too late to contact the school. Let us know what's going on, and we investigate thoroughly, and we don't do it alone. We do it often in conjunction with the Revere Police and Fire if necessary, and we work with the families at hand. Everything is kept confidential, and we really, nothing is deemed to be not a threat until we fully investigate. All right, Captain O'Hara, I'm going to turn it to you for contacting the Revere Police.
Thank you. So we've listed several ways that you can report concerning behavior. Obviously, Superintendent Gallucci talked about going to trusted adults, and we talked about building trust with offices where you can go for an officer. But if you have an emergency, you can call 911. You can also text a 911. I just want to recognize the director of our regional dispatch in the audience, Elizabeth Belmonte. Most you may not know, but our regional dispatch, where our calls go, are a separate agency, but they're housed inside our police department. She works very closely with us. So she knows a lot about the text to 911. It's her employees that will be answering that and the 911 calls. For non-emergencies, you can call the regular business line, but the Revere Police Department also has an anonymous tip line that you can use by way of your cell phone, and the information on how to use that is right up there. You text the keyword to Revere PD to 847-411. You can add a space, your tip information, and that's another way to report. But some of the earliest warning signs are made on social media, and that may indicate a risk. So pay attention and always be aware of that. Just report any concerns, especially emergency, trusted adults, and go right to 911. The other avenues, I would go secondary if there's an emergency.
All right, I'm gonna ask Ryan Ouellette to grab the microphone. We're gonna move on to our question and answers. You're welcome to pose any question to any member of the panel, and we'd love to get that question answered for you. If you'd like the microphone, you can just raise your hand and Ryan will bring it right over to you.
Thank you. My question is about training, and it was really reassuring to hear the type of training that the Revere Police and the optics officers go through in such detail, and it brought a sense of comfort to me to listen to that, so I thank you for that. And my question is, I had heard you mention that you do training for civilians, and I'm thinking about the SROs and the security teams, and I'm wondering, if somebody can talk about the type of security training in detail, with specifics, that the security team of the SROs go through, and whether there's been any discussions for our officers to provide some sort of training to the security team. I'm talking about the non-officer team members that work with the SROs.
I could start there. That's kind of a joint question, actually, for both myself and the captain. And when it comes down to the civilian, When it comes down to the SROs training in regards to working with the staff that they have, because the SROs, they work with the security staff of all the schools, and the SROs are constantly working with that staff, kind of giving them options on, if this situation happens, then you should do this, this, this. Because obviously that security staff's role, they're not a police officer, you know, they're not armed or anything like that, but they're an asset to the SRO and they're an asset to all of us in regards to things like early detection, early warning of an incident. And then when an incident develops, they can they can help us in the resolution of that incident. So the SROs handle that, and I know, again, I'm not an SRO, but that being said, the captain here, they have a program they work with, that they work with the SROs and they talk with them. Regardless of the other side of the house, the civilian side, there is the, we have, the school department reached out to us years ago, and they wanted to start going down this road of giving themselves more options. We started working with their administrative staff. At this point, I forgot how long ago, it was a while, and how to respond if an incident occurred in the schools. We advised them a best course of action, things like that, how to work with us and fire. There was training that we conducted with them. Since then, the school department has now come back to us, and they're now working what we call options-based training for their people, for their staff. We're in the initial phases of that with them, of advising them in which direction we're gonna go. There's various programs out there. One of the programs out there that's quite popular is called ALICE. I'm actually an ALICE instructor, and ALICE is a program intended to train for, you know, lack of a better term, civilians, but basically educators and things like that, train them on options-based response in such an incident. And when I say options-based, this is the deal. Whenever anything bad happens, you want tools in the toolbox, all right? And they're mental tools, so you know you have options on how to, on what to do. We want to keep those tools simple. All right, so like a police officer, the amount of training we go through, there's a lot of tools in that toolbox, and we have to be. A police officer nowadays kind of has to have a doctorate in some of the stuff that we do. When it comes to people that you didn't choose this path of life to be in a high-stress event and have to respond, we want to keep it simple, stupid. All right, so you see different programs from across the country, like ALICE, which is, it basically encompasses things like alerting everybody else, locking down the area you're in, communicating what's going on and such. You have Run, Hide, Fight, which is from Homeland Security. Run, Hide, Fight's a phenomenal program as well. You have the Texas Alert System. The Texas Alert System is one of the best programs in the country in regards to training law enforcement. We actually have them coming here to train. I've taken some of the courses, I'm gonna take it again. And we have several of our officers gonna go to it, along with some fire personnel, just to get some additional tips in September. So they're coming down here with several staff to train PD and FD on how to respond. Alert now also offers civilian training. So we're in the initial phases with the school department. I don't want to comment too much about what their future plans are. The captain's going to take it from here. But we're going down that road of now bridging beyond us. Because again, like I hope I got the point across that I'm very confident. Like, I'm not going to stand here and put myself out there and say that we're doing something right if we're not. All right, we are. Revere Police Department, Revere Fire Department, is doing very good compared to others, all right, way better, in regards to active shooter response. I'm good with that, all right, and now I'm happy to say that the school department, they're on board, and now bridging that gap to go into the staff and help them have tools to respond.
Thank you. I just want to mention, Joe mentioned he's certified as instructor. Myself and the three SROs are actually going to training to be certified in options-based training as well. And we do want to bring it to the staff that are in the high school. And for anybody that might have anxiety about that, this type of options training is about situational awareness. It's the type of training that will help you not only in the school, but outside in your personal life, where you can, and also help, you know, talk to your family. It's one of the best practices, and we believe it's for an approach in all angles. We want to make sure everybody's prepared. So we're definitely looking in that area, and we hope to bring it to the school department, at least start with the staff. As far as the SROs, so we know that security in the buildings are just another layer of security, right? Like Sergeant Turner said, they're not security. But because sometimes they can often be the first contact if they're stationed at an entry into a school, I had mentioned earlier that we want to infuse into the curriculum some of the training is some of the situational awareness, because sometimes they could be the first contact. Like you said, it's training that will help everybody in their daily life, but in the school. But I think it'll be a great part of the curriculum to the security that is currently in the school department.
Thank you for doing this today, and I appreciate everyone coming together. I know that there was a big calling for it to bring this level of transparency out to everyone, so I wanted to say thank you to everyone up there putting this together. One of the questions that it came from Captain O'Hara's comments, culture and prevention obviously being probably the biggest pieces that you can help work on, because you know that's a big role. And a lot of this, a lot of the conversations are directed towards the SROs and the work that they're doing. Certainly, I'm a big proponent and fan of the work that they do, and we see it in the community. You know, Officer Singer, some of the just the networking, even before the boxing program, I remember having some troubled youth in football, and Officer Singer, you know, four or five years ago was really on top of, you know, the lifestyles of these children that, you know, needed a little bit more support. And I guess that leads me more into, I guess, some of the culture piece. Do we find, and this is probably more towards the school administration, do we find the SROs to be welcomed in all of our environments? Is it stressed and important that they are welcomed in our schools, and they're an important integral part in the relationship of developing relationships with students, with teachers, with faculty, but also in that prevention method, so that each school knows that, you know, when they're in the building, they're not... understanding the political climate that's out there and understanding the hard job that police officers have these days, they're not the enemy from within. They're actually there to help. They're there as a big support staff, especially, I mean, teddy bears, right? I mean, think about Joe and Officer Brennis and the other Joe. They're probably the most welcoming police officers I've ever met, for that matter. But is that embedded in the culture of how we view our law enforcement in our schools?
So let me start by saying that's probably a great question for the students. And it's one that we visit with them. My own observation is that the kids absolutely love our SROs, and I'll give you one anecdote from that. When George Floyd was murdered, we held a town hall meeting to help our students process that event. We were at home because of COVID. We were not in school at the time. So it was a particular challenge for helping students process that when we weren't together with them in the same physical space. And on that community event, the mayor was there, other folks were there. The topic of SROs came up because at that time there was a large national push to remove SROs from schools. And one thing I can tell you is the students, it was an adult on the meeting who said, I think we should remove the SROs from our public schools. And the students immediately came back and said, no, not our SROs. We do half-day hoops. We have the boxing league. They help us in the cafeteria. They're unbelievable. So at least the kids, and it was multiple kids on that event, spoke out in huge support of the SROs. But I think there are some differences between what our SROs do in Revere and in Massachusetts in general than what you see around the nation. And that's sometimes where you get these different mindsets. In Massachusetts, as Captain O'Hara mentioned, our SROs do 60 hours of training every year to be an SRO. That's in addition to all of the training Sergeant Turner talked about that all Revere police officers go through. So they are highly skilled and purposefully selected because of their intentionality around helping youth and understanding adolescents and being anti-biased and anti-racist in their work. And our students see that, which is why I think that they embrace them so much. In other parts of the country, you have untrained police officers, often at the end of their career, looking for a little bit of a break, who get assigned to a school, or maybe they've been in some kind of trouble, so they get assigned to a school. That's not how we operate in Revere. So it's a very different experience for the kids to work with our SROs than kids across the country might be experiencing. And they do things here like wear a polo shirt with an embroidered badge and khaki pants instead of riot gear, because we want the kids to feel like they're safe in school, not that they're in a prison. And I think that mindset, that culture of we're a team, we're here to help each other, we're here to work together and do everything we can to keep everybody safe is really important in setting the tone for how we engage with one another.
I just want to add something because it's a training element. To piggyback what you said, to understand the, we'll say the temperature of SRO topic in the United States of America for law enforcement, she's not wrong in regards to that unfortunateness that in some jurisdictions, it's definitely not local. Massachusetts is now started a standardization with SROs, as in they have to go to a state-approved school. And all our officers are squared into it. In Massachusetts, you're not going to be able to sit there and bend the rules and things like that. Other jurisdictions, it can be a camping ground. It can be a place where they put police officers, shouldn't be SROs. I need to give props to the SRO staff. I do a lot in my agency. I would never want to be an SRO. The amount of work that involves is immense to me, and they work extremely hard, all right? In the things I do, I'm on call a lot. I feel like they're on call 24/7, and they work their absolute butts off. That said, police officers can get real disenchanted if we're treated, when people treat us wrong, we get disenchanted about what we do. Those officers, I have never heard one word out of their mouth ever about, I don't want to keep doing this. They love what they do, and they would only love what they do if they were getting that atmosphere from the kids, all right? The look on Officer Singer's face when he gets a kid to hang out at his program instead of doing something else that could be doing that might not be healthy for him, he loves it. It's an intrinsic motivation for him. I can't say enough about them. Regards to the training side of the house, Massachusetts is doing very well. I say the captain is annoying to me in regards to coming to me and saying, can you get my SRO into this? Can you get my SRO into that? Can you get my SRO into this class? I send those SROs to more training than any other officer in my agency. Even SWAT officers and TPO officers, they get more training. All right, they are highly skilled officers, and I'm very proud of the three of them, and I call them all friends. So.
I just want to mention, as part of police reform, obviously, there was a whole portion of SROs in the particular training that they had to go to. We were already ahead of it. They have all the training that Massachusetts now creates as a standard. We're already ahead of it because we know how important it is to have the right training and have the best officers with good skills inside the schools.
Hi, this question is for the school department. So as a parent, I'm concerned about the communication. How and when, as a parent, will we receive that communication if there is an event that's unfolding in our child's school?
So we discussed this today, and what it would be is, if it's an emergency situation, the Revere Police Department would be posting that out to all families or the city of Revere or the school department. Obviously, when there's an emergency event at a school, their first priority is to call 911 immediately. Their second step is to notify central office, and then we as a central office start to work on the communication piece to the broader school community while they're dealing with the event. Obviously, sending support as needed, but once 911 is called, the emergency personnel is arriving, and that's how the communication would be put out. We have a system whereby we can contact any school community individually. We can obviously do mass communication as well. We can text message, email, and phone call, all three simultaneously, to get that out to the community when it's appropriate. We begin to take our communication plans from the emergency personnel that's responding. Once they give us the green light to communicate out, what families should do, where they should meet, where they should convene, we would push that out as the school department.
Thank you.
And I would just add that we would be working in conjunction with the police department and the mayor's office. So looking at any of our messaging on social media would probably be the most immediate place that you'd see if something major happened, to get information on where you should go or what we're doing to try to reunite families. I think it's going to be really event specific, depending on, you know, one of us will be taking the lead on getting that communication out, but all of us will be retweeting or reissuing that communication. And I'll just add, for when we become aware of an incident, like Dr. Gallucci talked about earlier, how students have reported to us since we've done the Sandy Hook Promise training numerous times, if something happened in your school, we still report it to parents. A letter goes home that night, it gets emailed, a phone call goes out saying, please look at your email, and it gives as much detail as we can give without violating any student privacy. But we have had a couple of incidents where students have brought a kitchen knife to school or or something like that, or kids tell us that they heard something about a backpack. We share that information now because the rumors spread so quickly on social media and the story gets so twisted that we want to make sure to get the truth out as quickly as we can to families so parents can understand exactly what happened in that situation. Very fortunately, we've been able to realize and remediate all of those issues before anything bad happened.
Just to follow up real quick, understand with an active shooter incident, it's very important to us that what's called a family reunification site is established and regards knowledge is put out. We're going to, law enforcement-wise, we're going to be asking the city to put stuff out. So that's going to be a priority. We're going to say, listen, put on information. It's literally part of our plans. We need that to happen. It's a necessity. So that's, communication is going to go out. And the best way in law enforcement we found to put information out is to flood. All right, we flood social media, news broadcasts, all that stuff. Because what we can't have is when we're trying to deal with an incident, have family come down to the incident site because it prevents our officers from doing their job, prevents fire from doing their job. If you have a firefighter that can't go inside with us and help save somebody because they have to help us keep people away, that's a problem. So we are going to get that information out there because we don't want to leave, because you're all parents. You guys love your kids. All right, and the fact is this, if I don't give you any information, what are you going to do? You're going right down that school. All right, so we're going to give you the information. We're definitely going to give it to you because that's the best way we can get you to trust us and allow us to do our jobs.
Thank you so much for putting this together. It's the first time I will have a kid in a school. So this is great because I have a lot of concern and this help a lot. I just have a question because I don't really know if the students are having any kind of training to really know what is something that they have to be concerned of.
Yes, so I know our elementary schools do a lot of work around safe talk and appropriate talk, and then identifying, given examples, what might be something that's not considered safe or appropriate for a school setting. Obviously, that training's a little different in the earlier grades with the little ones. As they get up to the fifth grade, it's a little more formal, like the middle school and the high school training. I think the training that we've had the past 2 years has been great. It's asked kids to go beyond verbalization. So not just what they hear, but to recognize if someone's starting to isolate or starting to get down in the dumps or someone who needs support that's a peer. And then our work from here, we have a wealth of resources from those 2 years, and now to create our own district, see something, say something type of program that spans all of our grades, that's kind of our next step this year. I think what our big step this year will be as a school district is identifying those trusted adults that I had mentioned early on, ensuring that we introduce our SROs. I also want to say Officer Singer and Officer Brennis are right here with us, but introducing them with the students and thank them for all their work of course. Typically, they don't need an introduction, but there may be students in the building, like you just said, your child will be attending for the first time, who are going to see them and wonder who they are. And to identify them as a trusted adult who can provide support if needed, if they don't have a teacher or someone that they can connect to immediately. And I also want to give them kudos because even beyond what started as half-day hoops and evolved to Officer Singer's amazing boxing program that's brought so many kids in, Officer Brennis has started to recognize that a lot of kids are into soccer and has started that kind of extracurricular work with our kids as well. The work they do is amazing, but I do think it's a team effort between administrative staff, counseling staff, our SROs, and of course, all of our teaching staff, paraprofessionals, custodians, dining services members. In the middle school, there were kids that had great connections with the person that served them their food every day. You never know who the trusted adult's going to be. And that's why we definitely encourage you to have that conversation with your children.
And I'll just add, Dr. Gallucci, another priority that we have for this coming school year is not just making sure the kids know who the SROs are, but making sure they know who everybody else is. They know who the social worker is, and what does a social worker do? How is that different than the nurse? When do I ask to go to the social worker instead of the nurse? And what about my guidance counselor? How is my guidance counselor different from my social worker? And what about the assistant principal? We haven't taken conscious steps to make sure all students understand these different positions and these different roles. And it's one of our priorities, one of our action steps for this year, is to make sure that we do that intentionally with all students.
Thank you. One more thing.
Sure.
So you mentioned that there is a way that you teach the little kids. Mm-hmm. So are we as a parent getting that information so we can reinforce them and do the same thing?
Absolutely. Just in line with what Dr. Kelly just talked about, just as we send home materials for academics, these are what the kids are learning, these are the strategies that we're encouraging, the same will be done in terms of what we're promoting for social-emotional learning. Here's what we're talking about. I know recent conversation with the Hill School principal is really going back to safe talk and what's appropriate, and that was the example that I had referenced. Well, what does that look like? And do we send that home to the families and ensure that it's translated into our primary languages in the district? So yes, you can definitely anticipate seeing that at home to be able to make that connection with your child as to what they learn in the day and then reinforcing at home.
I'm just thinking about the district and 8,000 students, and we're talking about the SROs, and I'm wondering whether 3 SROs are enough. I mean, there's no doubt they're doing amazing work, but at the same time, we don't want to burn these guys out. And I'm just wondering if there's an ideal, not thinking about budget or anything like that, but whether there's an ideal image of what you imagine the perfect situation to be. Is there a number of SROs we're striving to get? Or I just want to have this idea in my mind so we're all on the same page and what we're trying to work towards, you know, come next year when we're talking about budgets and other considerations.
I'll go first and then I'll pass it over to the chief of police. I think that from my own perspective as a leader of the school district, one thing that I would love to see is a female SRO who could work with our female students more closely when they're experiencing different kinds of struggles. So that's somewhere that I feel that we have a need. The other place that I feel that we have a need is, or where we could use more support, is in language. Officer Brennis speaks Spanish, and he's an incredible resource to us throughout the district when we have Spanish-speaking families that need assistance. But we have a lot of Arabic-speaking families and a lot of Portuguese-speaking families. So there are definite pieces, definite gaps that I would love to see us fill. I don't know what the magic number is. I don't know if the chief has a better idea of that. Right now, we have Officer Brennis is stationed out of this building and also responds to the Hill or the Lincoln School. Officer Singer is at the high school and also responds to the Romney Marsh, so they're in close proximity. And Officer Internicola is on the east side of the city and takes care of he's out of the Garfield complex, but also visits the Beachmont and the Paul Revere. So fortunately, even though we have 8,000 students, we have 8 complexes, 8 buildings, and right now the 3 SROs cover them well. I don't think it could be harmful to have one more, so that each of them were responsible for 2 buildings.
Hi, we're in the process right now of sending another officer to SRO school, and we're probably gonna look further down the road to send other officers as well. But we have a lot of our officers that do interact at the school, so we're very open to that and to have engagement with the students. So, you know, we would definitely like to expand it, and we're going to look towards doing that.
I just want to mention that what the superintendent said about having an officer, a female officer, she also does speak Spanish, the officer that we are considering. But SROs are a layer of security, right? They're not a foolproof way of preventing anything, but they are a layer of security. You know, but the chief and I always talk about this. Every officer, we have a lot of officers that work during the day that are around, and they're another layer of security. They're not actually assigned to the school, but they're heavily involved with school and throughout the programming in the city.
And the chief just made me think of one more thing that I wanted to mention. We do part, like all of the Revere police officers, even if they're not SROs, are unbelievably supportive and cooperative. Like if we have, when I think of female students in particular, occasionally they'll report to the school that there might have been some abuse that happened to them. There are officers who specialize in that, and immediately the SROs call and say, we need this person to come. And that officer who specializes comes and helps facilitate that issue so that we can make sure that particular student is safe. Even though it's not an active shooter situation or something like that, it's still a student safety issue that we want to address.
Yeah, and I think my thought process on it wasn't necessarily as like Captain America of the schools, but more so with the building of relationships with the students and being able to get to more students. It's a matter of numbers, and the numbers, you know, as now, are disproportionate. But also, it's, you know, there's so many wonderful side effects to having these offices in the school. And one obvious positive is having them present and students engaging with them in a way that they haven't, and switching up that narrative that's been out, you know, in our culture and in the media, and breaking down those barriers between law enforcement and youth, particularly youth of color, which you know, our schools are predominantly comprised of. So I just feel that three officers is wonderful. They're doing great work, and the positive effects that come from their presence are abundant. I just wish that we had more of that, because I just don't see how three officers are going to be able to make. I feel like more can make more connections.
Right. Well, thank you for bringing that up. Obviously, I'm part of the chief's command staff, and I overlook the school resource offices, but I'm in the community services division. And a top priority of his administration is engagement with all officers. So a lot of our officers are involved with our police activities league, right? Not just the SROs. They're involved. We partner up with Revere Rec and our offices there. We don't want officers sitting in cruises that reinforce somebody that may have a negative attitude. Getting out of our vehicles and having these positive interaction is a priority of any administration. And it also goes back to what I said about averting violence in the first place. You want to have trusting relationships in place so that we are communicating. You feel comfortable coming forth to any officer with information. But it's a great question, but it's a priority of the chief's administration that every officer should be interacting with youth in positive ways and with the community in positive ways.
Thank you. Good evening. Thank you all for being here. This has been incredibly eye-opening and comforting. My question is, God forbid something happened, a lockdown, a shutdown, an active shooter, the first person that these children are going to look at is their teacher. So my question is, what type of training are teachers receiving for these types of situations?
Well, I'd like to address that because we touched upon this. So myself and three school resource officers are actually going to training next week to have certification in options-based training, which Sergeant Turner is already trained in. And we are in discussions with the superintendent about bringing this type of training to the educators and the adults in the building. It's just about situational awareness and being aware of what you can do based on the knowledge that you have. So it's training that we're looking to bring into the curriculum, not just educators, security, custodians, because it's the best option to understand what you can do during this a critical incident like this. You need a little bit of training with situational awareness.
So, and I'll just add to that, we don't expect in the school department that teachers and other staff members need to be skilled the way our police officers are in law enforcement or containment or thwarting events. What we want to do is give them what Sergeant Turner referred to as tools in the toolbox so that they can have options and understand what the research shows about best ways to react in different situations. I think the truth of the matter is that every single one of these situations is unique and different. There are nuances to all of them. And where a critical event occurs in a building is going to influence how a teacher should react to it, depending on where they are in relation to an incident. What we want to do is work with the police department to build the skill set for teachers and give kind of a, and all staff, and give a basic, these are ways that you can respond. You're still going to have to decide in a moment what you're going to do. And for those teachers who want to have a more advanced toolbox, we're going to do some more advanced training for them, not required. A certain level of training is going to be required for everybody, but there'll be more advanced training for those people who are interested in it. I think one of the things that we have to be really careful about balancing is the idea that the school staff, outside of our proactive measures, are going to take extreme measures to interact with a situation that a police officer might be trained to do, that a teacher or a custodian or a secretary or a superintendent might not be trained to do. And really just give everybody that attention, that ability. We've been talking about doing it not just with school staff, but also with parents and students who might be interested in learning more about this. As the captain said, this is a life skill for everybody to understand situational awareness and be able to look around and assess whether something's off and whether you should move or get help or whatever. We want to approach it as a community so that all of us are better at these skills.
And I would just add, to see the school teams in action is amazing. So the building leaders, principals, do a great job of establishing who has what role in each building. And to watch an entire middle school of nearly 700 students evacuate in 3 to 4 minutes, and that's from the time the first buzzer sounds to the last person exiting the building, and then just another 3 minutes to account for every single solitary person in the school is just incredible to watch. Some teachers are responsible for going to the site where if we had a student on crutches to be able to work with that student. Typically that's not a classroom teacher, that's someone that's free. Guidance counselor, math coach, someone that is not probably gonna have students in front of them at that moment. And they do a really great job, and I'm talking about our principals, of planning that out and making sure it's communicated early on and reinforced throughout the school year.
I'll just add to that, Richie. Our office is at the high school. So whenever there's a drill at the high school, we're part of it. Every human in every building is part of the drills that we do. And it is incredible to watch a building with over 2,000 students and over 200 staff members empty out. As he said, it takes a little more than 3 minutes at the high school. But the most amazing thing is to listen after when the principal, who's usually in command, does the check to make sure every human has been accounted for, and to hear the assistant principals and the other people who assigned oversight say things like, I need to know where Richie Gallucci is. He was on the second floor near the elevator on crutches. And somebody else come over and say, we have Richie Gallucci outside of the auditorium with Mrs. Stackpole's class. Like, literally, these are the conversations that go after every one of these situations, and it continues until we get to the all clear. And different people, the principal will be saying, Dr. Kelly, are we all clear at the superintendent's office? All clear. And then an assistant principal, are we all clear? All clear. And it goes until we get a full all clear, and that's when we report back to the fire department that we've got everybody, and then they make a determination when we go back in the building. It is incredible to watch.
All right, we're about 25 minutes over, so I'm gonna take one final question. If you have a final question, please raise your hand, and Ryan will bring you the microphone to close us out.
Thank you for the meeting. My question is I want to know if that's possible for this year, putting one or two officers inside and in the schools, you know, if that's 8 hours a day, I don't know if that's possible that, like a family, every family, we can pay money, the officers. So if that's possible, because I my son, he told me that last time, like 3 months ago, this incident over there in another school, in the Romney March, I guess. So I worry for that. So I want to know if that's possible for this year, putting one or two officers inside in the schools. We can pay. I don't know if that every family we can pay, I don't know, $10, $50 each week, but it'll start this year. Don't wait. We don't have to wait for any incident inside in the schools. They're going to be late. So the police come in 3 or 4 minutes later when the incident that happened, it's too late. So we need the police inside.
So Officer Singer is inside the high school. He's stationed at the high school, and he takes care of the Romney Marsh. His office at the high school is at the end of the building that's right across the parking lot from Romney Marsh. I can introduce you to him after the meeting if you like. He is here. Want to give a wave? We definitely have the three officers that are inside of the schools right now, and we would like to add at least one more. I don't know if it's the best use of the police resources to have people all day at the schools. I will say that whenever there is an issue, like after what happened in Uvalde, the chief sends all of the sector cars to the schools, and they stay at the schools all day for a few days after to make sure nothing happens.
I want to give you a little context. If you look at active shooter incidents since 2001. The FBI has done a very good job of tracking the statistics of active shooter incidents. A large amount of active shooter incidents, a SRO was in the building at the time. Your heart's in the correct spot that if you put a police officer in every single building, that would somehow prevent an active shooter incident from ever occurring. The statistics show that's not the case, all right? Yes, you can't get lucky in that help. If the active shooter happens to come in the door nearest where the SRO is at the time, that could happen. But what about this? Today I was training at the high school, up on the third floor of the high school. What if the SRO is assigned to the high school and he's in the high school the entire time? He's up on the third floor, walking around, visiting the kids. An active shooter comes in on the first floor. I don't know, you know, if you've ever done sprints or anything like that, but how fast could you run from the third floor all the way down to the first floor? It takes time. The way that we're present everywhere is by multifaceted preparation, okay? That has to do with our SROs, they're all issued their own cars, all right? Like, I don't have a take-home car. The SRO has a take-home car. His car is with them at all times. His car is fully equipped so that he can quickly respond to different parts quickly. Our patrol officers are assigned to sectors in the city, so they're present in general areas of those cities, of our city. That's our multi-pronged part. You can put, like where you start, you're like, can we have 1 to 2 officers in every single school? We could do that, but then active shooter incidents will still happen across the country, and then we need 4 officers in every single school, 5 officers, 6 officers, 10 officers, 12 officers, and it can go on and on. The fact is this, unless you put an officer in every single classroom, there's always gonna be some time gap. And that's, SROs are so important in so many ways. When it comes to the actual stopping of the incident, statistically speaking, they're not usually the first ones to be able to stop it because they're doing all these other things. Their job is not just security, and that's where your heart is. You're like, they're just security. All right, they're not just security. Their job is to prevent this. Prevention, I'm up here to talk about response, and that's, we don't want to be there. We don't want to be in the realm that we have to get to that point where the off that SRO has to go to that part of his job. The SRO's most important part of this job is the prevention aspect of it, and that's the multi-pronged element where they work with the community policing aspect. They work with the school department. See something, say something. You guys in here right now, you have to understand something. We are only so good as our job as the community allows us to be. All right, in the end run, this father over here wants to protect his children. All right, he's willing to pay out of pocket to do such. All right, he loves his children. Well, guess what? That man right there loves his kids. If your child comes home and they say something to you that Mikey said this or Timmy said that, that is very important. We don't know what they said unless you tell us. All right, this is not about getting people in trouble. This is about protecting people's children. All right, we can put an officer in every single school. That still won't stop this problem in this country. I do not know why this problem exists. I wish I did. All right, but the fact is this, we have to look at this as a multi-pronged approach, and that's how we stop it. All right, it's all of our responsibilities. Mine, fire, school departments, command staff, and every single one of you in here. We all keep these kids safe. We all make sure that kid gets off that bus, goes home to you, you guys have dinner, and you watch a movie. All right?
The final piece that I would add to that is our SROs do a great job in scheduling themselves to be present in all of the schools throughout the week. I was a principal at the Romney Marsh Academy for 6 years. There was not an SRO office in my school, but I would regularly see Officer Singer, Officer Brennis at the time, constantly present in my school. And Officer Brennis might spend a Tuesday in my school. He might split the day between the Susan B. Anthony and the Romney, or Officer Singer, same thing. There's a consistent presence in all 11 of our schools, all 8 of our buildings. And you never can predict where an SRO is going to be. And they do such a great job. And I mean that from my heart. In 6 years, I never felt a lack of an SRO presence in my school building. And there was no office at my building. All right. With that, I am going to close us out. I'm going to thank each and every one of you for attending tonight. Thank you to Revere TV for recording this and making it available asynchronously. Thank you to all of the leaders in our Revere community for all of their work. And as Captain O'Hara said, school safety is all of our responsibilities, and I think this was a great first step for us as a Revere community, and I thank each and every one of you.